Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to be here. Happy 25th anniversary to Fulbright. The greatest thing is actually being part of this community, and I would really like to continue being part of it. So my presentation today is entitled, Does Technology Have a Death Wish? And this is actually a quote from Don DeLillo's novel, and I hope that by the end of this presentation you will be able to ask or answer this particular question. So DeLillo actually has been called the novelist of the ultra-contemporary, and he always puts his finger on the most important issues of the day. So he is actually interested in the boundaries between the artificial and the natural, where you have science and religion of technology merging together. This particular novel is actually a somber and deeply contemplative text. It is what I would call speculative fiction, dealing with the post-human condition. And here, in order to explain what I mean by speculative fiction, I will use a quote by Donna Haraway, who has said that the boundary between science fiction and social reality is an optical illusion. DeLillo creates actually a fictional world that is quite similar to our contemporary life, dominated by science awash in irrepressible fantasy. I will try to say a little bit, just a brief definition of what we mean by speculative fiction. And here I will base this on Margaret Atwood, who is a Canadian writer and has written a lot in the field. Speculative fiction, as she defines it, refers to stories set on Earth and employing elements that already exist in some form, and that is different from science fiction, where you're actually talking about hypothetical ideas such as time travel. So I think that speculative fiction has actually proven to be extremely important in today's life because it envisions a lot of the things that actually happen to us. And here, of course, just a brief reference to what we were already talking the previous speakers. So since nature and human biology have already been drastically modified by technology, the post-human condition, I would argue, is actually one of the present moment. Technology has become a force of nature, writes DeLillo. We can't control it. It comes blowing over the planet, and there's nowhere for us to hide. End of quote. So Don DeLillo examines the ontological quest for self-definition of the human being, realized in confrontation with the technological. He is further testing the undefined and undefinable boundaries of what it means to be human, of self, of identity, in a fashion that is similar to another writer, Stephen Hall, who actually says that the human being is, I quote, a concept wrapped in skin and chemicals. DeLillo poses the question whether it is possible to enter the post-human condition and to embrace all the promises and all the threats of technology without actually being tempted by visions of unlimited power or by immortality. So can the human being consider the possibility of re-encountering himself, as he says, like a newborn machine, and still remain human? In this context, technology is once again, as he says, seen with apprehension, anticipation, and awe. Now, the topicality of DeLillo's work is revealed both in the temporal and in the spatial setting of the novel, and I will walk you through that. First of all, the novel is divided into two parts, and the first part is entitled In the Time of Chelyabinsk. And here I will remind you that the Chelyabinsk meteor came very close to Earth in February 2013, and that the power that was released from it is actually 20 to 30 times greater than the atomic bomb in Hiroshima, and it led to skin burns and retina burns of people. So the second part of the novel is entitled In the Time of Konstantinovka, which invokes another trail of recent traumatic events that are based on perverse nationalist fervor and authoritarian ambitions, imperialistic leanings. Maybe I should remind you here that Konstantinovka is actually part of the Donetsk region of southeastern Ukraine, and in 2014, the city turned into one of the sites of the armed conflicts between the pro-Russian separatist forces and the Ukrainian government. To further blur the hazy line between fact and fiction, Delillo sets the novel in, the setting of the novel is in southern Kazakhstan, which is close to the border with Kyrgyzstan. And it was in the eastern corner, far eastern corner actually, of Kazakhstan, near Semipalatinsk, that, as you probably are aware, the Soviet Union established its top secret nuclear facility. And it is here that for over 50 years, from 1949 till 1989, more than 500 bombs were detonated, some of them above Earth, which actually led to exposure of the people who were living there. And today there are many birth defects, there are many genetic modifications, which are actually the result of this exposure. So science and religion have come to clash and converge in a world fearful of death and eager to look to technology for solution, even salvation. So having brought to light the fact, this is again a quote from the novel, that the defining element of life is that it ends, Delillo has done this in multiple ways in his preceding novels as well. But he portrays the two central characters of his novel Zero K as seeking to conquer death, paradoxically, by submitting to it. The two main characters are Ross Lockhart, who is a billionaire financier, and his wife Artis, who is suffering from a terminal illness. Ross is also an investor in a facility which is called the Convergence, situated, as I said, in southern Kazakhstan, and their failing bodies are euthanized and then cryogenically frozen and stored until a time when, presumably in the future, they will be resurrected. One can only assume by yet unknown scientific procedures, probably cellular regeneration or nanotechnology. Now, the zero K of the title actually comes from the Kelvin scale of temperature measurement, and it refers to absolute zero, which is minus 273 degrees Celsius. A special unit in the facility called zero K is set aside for the patients who wish to transition to the next level. Before their natural deaths, as Delillo writes, they die a while and then live forever. Now, Ross's beloved wife has no other choice but this form of assisted suicide, but Ross is healthy and he actually considers whether to follow her, which eventually he does, into the afterlife. So Delillo asks us to consider what the implications are of taking what he calls this existential leap into the prospect of life everlasting, which is the prerogative of those of breathtaking wealth who can indulge their fantasies of immortality. And the opening line of the novel points precisely to the commercializations of all these transactions regarding afterlife. I quote, "Everybody wants to own the end of the world." In accordance with the speculative fiction of the novel, Delillo's visualization concerning cryonic experiments, though seemingly futuristic, is actually not that futuristic. It's part of our present-day reality. So the modern-day movement of cryonics was presumably founded by Professor Robert Ettinger, who launched it with his book, The Prospect of Immortality, published in 1964. I believe it's an important detail to point out that previously he had a short story, which was science fiction, in which he first developed this idea. So again, you have this kind of blurring between science and fiction. So he went on to found the Cryonics Institute in 1976. He served as its president until 2003, and following his death, he was frozen, and he now remains there, preserved alongside the bodies of his mother and his two wives. Cryonics, this is actually a slide showing the membership of the Cryonics Institute as of 2017. As you can see, the members are quite many. They're also pets, not just humans. So cryonics is defined by the Cryogenic Society of America as, I quote, the belief that a person's body or body parts can be frozen at death, stored in a cryogenic vessel, and later brought back to life. The first person to actually undergo such body preservation in 1967 was University of California psychology professor James Bedford. Of course, the technology has developed much more from that point onward. It's inevitable that I make a comparison with the mummies that I've seen at the British Museum, because the very process of vitrification, which is actually an ice-free process, so have more than 60% of the water inside the body replaced with protective chemicals. I don't know how that really works. I just read it. So suspended animation, I'll just give you further examples, is a descriptive term that is used on the site of Alcor, which is one of the foremost companies in the United States that is preserving life through science. And here you can see the executive of that particular foundation. And this phrase, suspended animation, is also used on page 16 of the novel. Now, you can see here some of the data, perhaps, how much it costs. I'm not selling. I'm not an Alcor representative here, sales agent. But in case you're interested how much it costs, you have two offers. You have a whole body cryopreservation, which is over $200,000. That's the minimum. Or you have only head preservation, which is also called neuropreservation, and that would be on the about $800,000. Now, of course, the brain is considered to be the most important part of the human body, because presumably that's where memory is stored, and presumably the self or your own identity. The issue of cryonics is an after-death prospect was widely discussed in the media. I'll just give you a couple of examples. One of them was in 2002 when baseball legend Ted Williams had his body frozen. Another interesting debate was followed the cryopreservation in the Cryonics Institute of a 14-year-old British girl who died of cancer, and she wanted her body to be preserved so that she would hopefully be revived sometime in the future. And since she was underage, her father did not allow this, so they had to take this to court, and finally she was allowed to be cryopreserved. So there, in a way, this is a precedent, I believe, so now there is really no age limit as to this particular procedure. Several very famous personalities, public figures, have actually said that they would want to do that. One of them is the futurist Ray Kurzweil, who said that his primary strategy for living through the 21st century and beyond is not to die. So an article in the Financial Times that I read recently claims that in the long-established tradition, actually, of the Cold War, there is a similar freezing operation going on in Russia, which is called, the company is called CryoRus, Rus probably, and now the interesting thing is that they are expanding in Europe. They have a Russian and Swiss joint venture. This is a new company, Cryogen, planning to build a European center in the Swiss Alps, so hence the reference to Frankenstein here. And there are two novelties actually introduced. One is that they will do the freezing before death. Now, this is actually against laws in many countries. You have to be first legally announced dead, and then you can undergo the procedure. But they will be offering mercy freezing, as they call it, which is before death. And you can pay for this with cryptocurrency. So now you've got cryo token. So if you're interested, you can actually buy cryo tokens to be used in the future. So how is the cryonic prospect rendered in 0K? So this particular facility, which is described there, is both a kind of a bizarre art project. It's like a temple, it's like a tomb, it's like a bunker. And Delillo describes the operation as an endeavor which is, beyond the limits of believability and law. So actually the facility with its complex structure of many levels, endless hallways, doors opening to the wrong place, an ascetic minimalist design is defined by its orienting aesthetics. The text actually remains ambiguous as to this question, what is the role of the over-designed space of the convergence? Does it serve to comfort the patients or to deceive them? To comfort those who have come to die by attempting to remove all the practicalities of the process. And actually, Delillo has left out all the technical things. There is no technical or scientific terms in the text. Or alternatively, is this, one of the strategies used to market death? The convergence is also presented as a shrine to technology where a refuge from mortality can be found, as Delillo says, by the rows of human bodies in gleaming pods. The human body appears quite often as art, I quote, with broad implications, just as the novel itself with its epigrammatic, stylistic minimalism. The body here is actually quite often rendered as an exhibit, a museum piece that is suspended there, a sculpture devoid of life to be contemplated, but also it is very often objectified and reduced by technology to something similar to the plastic molded mannequins that are kind of spread throughout the facility. Maybe this is Delillo's answer to the question about the future of cryonics. One particular scene that I would like to mention here, which for me is very important, is the scene between the so-called vital minds and the benefactors in the convergence. Whether they are scientists, whether they're philosophers, priests, or simply sales agents, and marketing experts remains unclear, but they have the parameters of their vision, which is the unacceptability of death. The dreams of refreshing organs, regenerating systems, and stretching the boundaries, I quote, of what it means to be human, stretch and then surpass, are intertwined with all the star existential questions that we can find running through most of Delillo's work. And what's the point of living if we don't die at the end of it? Isn't death a blessing? How human are you without your sense of time? More human than ever? Or do you become fetal, an unborn thing? Do you think about the future? What will it be like to come back? The same body, yes, or an enhanced body? But what about the mind? Is consciousness unaltered? Are you the same person? What strikes the reader actually is the extremity of the convergence ethos marked by the convergence of religion and technology. The long and narrow room in which the meeting of the visionaries takes place resembles the austere interior of a Protestant church with the wooden benches, the scarred oak table facing them. There is even an altar of sorts consisting of an oversized human skull cracked in places, stained with age, a lurid coppery bronze, a drained gray. The eye holes are rimmed with jewels and the jagged teeth painted silver, end of quote. This description at least brought to my mind this very famous piece of Damien Hirst, if you remember it, called For the Love of God, which consists of platinum plates and diamonds and real human teeth. So in keeping with this emerging religion of technology, the cryonized humans are presented actually as heralds entering the portal. The bodies in waiting before they become the dormants in capsules or pods waiting for cyber resurrection. The priests of this new religion of faith-based technology are looking to establish a different God, at the same time foreseeing that, I quote, a religion of death will emerge in response to our prolonged lives, for who would want to live forever? Providing many and shocking examples for the ambiguity of death, following many natural and man-made disasters that have caused bleeding and ruptures, Delillo actually intertwines a theme of technology and death, this is his trademark, pursuing relentlessly the ethical dimensions. He aims to subvert the dance of transcendence, and the reader, just as the iconic Delillian character, is lost and disoriented in a Kafkaesque feeling of nowhereness. We are painfully aware of the protagonist in his life of desuetude, that is, wasted time as a life pursuit. And we're also aware, I quote, of the maze-like moments of time suspended, content blunted, the lack of explanation, end of quote. Perhaps then, death is ultimately an absolute necessity. Perhaps then it is there either to provide the ever elusive meaning, or a much needed escape, or simply finitude to the futility with which Delillo's text overwhelms us. He actually inserts a very useful reminder when he quotes Saint Augustine, "And never can a man be more disastrously in death than when death itself shall be deathless." Thank you.